to the cloud. Yeah, let me share. So, but I think the rank nullity theorem is one of the most important results we're going to cover in this course. We will see a lot of other important results, but this is very fundamental. It's very fundamental results and very useful. You can actually apply it. I already presented one application of this result in the first lecture, basically as an illustration of what linear algebra can do. Okay, today we will see more applications. Okay, so this result sometimes informally called the rank nullity theorem. It's also known by other name, but I like the rank nullity theorem. Okay, good. So let me remind you that last week we defined three vector spaces which can be related to a matrix. If you have M times N matrix, matrix with M rows and N columns, you can define three vector subspaces. One is called a column space. It's a vector subspace spanned by all columns of the matrix A inside M dimensional space. All columns has M entries. So these columns leaves in the M dimensional space, Rm, and you can take all the columns, take the span, and this is a vector subspace called the column space. Absolutely in the same way, you can define a row space. You can take all rows of the matrix, consider them as vectors. You might transpose them so they become like vertical, and they live in the n dimensional space. You take the span, and this is a row space. And more difficult, you can define a kernel of the matrix. You take a matrix A and you take all vectors in Rn such that if you multiply this vector by matrix A on the left, you get zero vector. All such vectors form a vector subspace called kernel of the matrix. These are three very important subspaces which you can relate to a matrix. Using the result proved last week, we can show that we have these inequalities. Dimension of the column space is at most a minimum of M and N. Why? First of all, column space lives in Rm, so its dimension cannot be larger than M. Yeah. On the other hand, we have N columns, so dimension cannot be larger than N. If all columns are linearly independent, their dimension is exactly N. But this is not always true. Okay, absolutely in the same way, we see that dimension of the row space is a minimum, at most minimum bit of M and N. This follows from the results of the last week. Okay, let's consider some example. Okay, people still joining. It's okay. So let's consider this 4x4 matrix. Yeah, and you see, I took this matrix to be a bit special. So one row is zero. I did it deliberately. It's actually more special than you can see. It's actually I will discuss it in a second. Yeah. So you can observe that actually, if you take third column can be obtained from the first two by adding them. Yeah. So on the other hand, first and the second column are linearly independent. This is not hard to prove. We did this we solved similar problems yesterday in the tutorial. So one can show that first and the second column are linearly independent, but the third column is actually a linear combination of the first two. So the three columns all together linearly dependent. So using this, you can show the dimension of the column space is two, because it cannot be smaller than two. Yeah, because it's already have two vectors that are linearly independent. But the third vector is actually a linear combination of the first two, so it's contained in the span of the first two columns. Yeah, okay. And absolutely in the same way, you can play around with the rows. You can observe that the fourth row it's a linear combination of the first and the third. The second row is actually zero, so it doesn't help us at all. Yeah, so to be precise, among the four rows, we could only choose two linearly independent vectors. Yeah, for example, it could be first and the third. Yeah, using this, you show that dimension of the row space is two. And this is not a coincidence. Yeah. Okay, and a less trivial statement, but maybe we should discuss it, that the linear space or kernel of this matrix A is actually one dimensional. Okay, so how to show this? There's two options how we can proceed now. Either you all think this is okay and we don't go over it, why kernel is one dimensional, or if you wish, I can actually explain this a little bit more using my whiteboard. Let me look what you think. Yes, explain please. Okay, then let me stop sharing for a second. Let me share the whiteboard. Yeah. Okay, so okay, but now I forget the matrix. Okay, give me 1, 3, 4, 2, 5, 7. The matrix was 1, 3, 4, 0, 0, 0, 2, 5, 7. And here was something 12, 35, 47. 12, 45, 37, 37, 47, 35. Okay. This is your A. When kernel of A, by definition, is all vectors x, y, z, such that A times x, y, z is a zero vector. It's going to be 0, 0, 0, and 0. Yeah. Let's just multiply A by x, y, z. This is shortcut. Four equations. 1, 3, 4 times x, y, z, it's going to be 1 times x plus 3 times y plus 4 times z equal to 0. Second equation is my favorite one. It's 0 times x plus 0 times y plus 0 times z equal to 0. The third equation, 2 times x plus 5 times y plus 7 times z equals 0. And finally, 12 times x plus 35 times y plus 47 times z equal to 0. So we have to solve this system of equations in order to find the kernel. But look, of course, we don't need this equation. This equation is just 0 equal to 0. It's redundant. Absolutely the same way, we don't need this equation. Why? Because as I already mentioned, the last row is a linear combination of the first two. It's a first row multiplied by 10 plus the third row. This means that this equation, which I erased, not erased, crossed, it can be obtained from the first equation and second equation by multiplying the first equation by 10, and you add this third equation, multiply by 1, and you get this equation. Okay, so we don't need it. So if this is 0 and this is 0, then this is 0. So to be precise, we have actually just two equations. Yeah. We have two equations and three unknowns. And basically, I can do what any of you can do, how to solve them. For example, I can use first equation to express x. So let me use different color just for fun. So I have x is minus 3y minus 4z. I substitute this into the second equation. I have 2 times minus 3 y minus 4 z plus 5 y plus 7 z equal to 0. I simplify this. I get minus 6 plus 5 minus y. Minus 8 plus 7 is minus z. Yeah, if I didn't do any mistake, equal to 0. So we got, we can take z to be anything, any number. I like Greek letters, so let it be lambda. And then y is minus lambda. And then z is, if you look at this, it's going to be, if z is, y is minus lambda, it's going to be 3 lambda minus 4 lambda. It means minus lambda. So my kernel consists of the vectors that looks like this, minus lambda, lambda, sorry, minus lambda and lambda. This means that my kernel can be, looks like lambda times vector minus one, one, where lambda any real number. In a fancy way, I can just say that my kernel is a span of vector minus one, minus one, one. Minus one, minus one, one is linearly independent vector. It spans the kernel. So it's a basis. So this vector is a basis of the kernel. So kernel is one dimensional. We just found the kernel explicitly. Okay, good. Let me stop sharing the whiteboard. And let's return to the slides. Okie dokie. Okay, good. So the kernel is one dimensional. Again, you have to do a lot of such exercises by yourself just to get used to these three notions, column space, row space, and the kernel of a matrix. They're all very important for this course. Okay, rank nullity theorem. Basically starts with the following lemma. First, we observe that the kernel, okay, there's someone late. Yeah, kernel of a matrix is an orthogonal complement to a row space, and a row space orthogonal complement to a kernel. Okay, probably it's good to illustrate as well by the whiteboard, which we just used. So if you look for these equations before I erased them, erase two remaining ones. What I just did, you can think of, for example, first equation as when you multiply the first row by the vector XYZ, but this is just a dot product. So you see, you can alternatively, you can translate my computations in the following language. You can say, I'm looking for vectors XYZ, which are orthogonal to the first row, second row, third row, and the fourth row of my matrix. But this means it should be orthogonal to the span of these vectors. But span of these vectors, it's a row space. And vice versa, you can actually see that the row space is orthogonal complement to kernel of my matrix A. It's actually a homework exercise. Let me see. Because orthogonal complement to orthogonal complements is the original space. Let me go back here. So kernel is orthogonal complement to row space. If you apply orthogonal complement twice, you get this, because if you take orthogonal complement twice, you get the same vector space. This is a part of homework. Okay, good. And it's actually, this follows from the results we proved in the last last lecture on Friday. Okay, good. We have this lemma, but we also proved that the sum of dimensions of orthogonal complement and the original space adds up to dimensional of the total space. This was the final theorem we stated and described how to prove on Friday lecture. So using this result for orthogonal complements, we conclude the dimension of the row space and dimension of the kernel space. If you add them, you get n. N is a number of columns. In some sense, this is one form of rank nullity theorem, but not complete form. To get to complete form, we need to say few more things. Okay, this is very important. So for example, if you use this corollary, you immediately can prove problem three in a homework assignment for 2x2 matrices. But for 2x2 matrices, the meaning of this problem in a homework assignment was basically try to prove this without using rank nullity theorem, or at least maybe without using it directly. You can use, for example, this equality, which follows, which was proved, and which follows from what I said, and you can use this equality because this was proved implicitly in the last lecture. We proved this equality in general for any vector subspace and its orthogonal complement. Yeah, but so basically you can feel free to use this to this corollary to prove solve your third problem in the homework assignment. Okay, good. And another restatement of the rank nullity theorem says that if you take dimension of the column space and add to dimension of the kernel space, it's also equals to n. Yeah, or you can restate it to say that dimension of the row space and the column space coincide, as we saw in the previous slide, in particular example for 4x4 matrix. This is not a coincidence, and this is also for 2x2 matrices, it's hidden in the problem three in the homework assignment for this week. Yeah, so all of this results more or less equivalent to the rank nullity theorem, but probably this is the most useful one. Dimension of the column space plus dimension of kernel is n, or dimension of the row space plus dimension of kernel is n. And the most important corollary is the dimension of the row space and dimension of the column space is the same. And okay, good. So let's prove rank nullity theorem. The proof, I must admit, a little bit abstract, but the idea, it's not so deep. So I strongly suggest to reread the proof, maybe a couple more times in the lecture notes where it's given with more details. Or maybe feel free to ask me about details and maybe consider some special cases, examples later after the lecture or during the office hours or during tutorial. This is important result. You will not be assessed to present its proof. No one gonna ask you to prove this theorem, for example, in an exam or in your homework. But I think to get some good feeling about linear algebra, it's better actually to understand the proof of this theorem and to know how to prove this, because actually the proof is very, very nice. And it's aesthetically, it's actually quite good. Okay, so we're gonna prove this theorem, which is the most important theorem of this lecture. And in my opinion, it's probably one of the most, maybe the most important result in the whole linear algebra course. Yeah, and definitely the most useful. Yeah. Okay, so let's do the by definition. We need to define dimension of these two guys here. So what is the dimension of the column space? We need to choose a basis of the column space, and we need to choose a basis of the kernel of matrix A. And then the number of vectors in a basis of column space, it's dimension by definition. Likewise, number of vectors in a basis of the kernel, it's a dimension of the kernel. So we have here L vectors and here we have K vectors. We have to prove that K plus L is N. That's it. Okay, from now on, we fix this basis. Yeah, there are many choices for a basis. We just picked some. Okay. Now, as I already we mentioned this last week, it was actually a lemma that if you have some collection of vectors in the n-dimensional space, you can expand it to a basis of the whole space. Yeah, and another thing which I mentioned probably twice or three times in the first lecture and on during the first week and also the last week, I mentioned that the column space can be obtained, vectors in the column space can be obtained from multiplying the matrix by vectors in Rn. So basically, for example, so column space, it's a span of columns. Okay, maybe it's actually a crucial point here. So maybe it's better to write it down so it's clear. So look, so you have any matrix, like for example, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah. What is a column space? Column space, it's a span of these three vectors. It's all possible linear combinations like this, lambda 1, 1, 4 plus lambda 2, 2, 5 plus lambda 3, 3, 6. All possible linear combinations. You take all possible numbers, lambda 1, lambda 2. You take all possible sums. This is a span of these vectors, 1, 4, 2, 5, 3, 6. And this is a column space by definition. But now you can observe that this vector, which is written here, it's nothing but A times lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3. Yeah. If you multiply, A by this vector, you get this. So another way of restating what is kernel, I can just restate, what is column space. Another way of restating what is column space, I can say that column space, after I use this observation, is all vectors AV for all possible V in R3. So here V is my lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3. I take all possible vectors in R3. I multiply by A. I get a bunch of vectors in this case in R2. This is my column space. This is a crucial observation. I stressed on this many times already, but let me stress it one more. Oh, let's wait. How to stop? Okay, good. Now we go back to the slides. So using this observation, I said that for every vector here lives in a column space by my choice. It's a basis. So all of these guys lives here. So I know that all of these guys can be obtained in the following way. I take some vector V in the Rn, multiply it by A, and I get Wi. So I call these vectors Vk plus I, Vk plus 1, Vk plus 2, up to Vk plus L. So I have these vectors. I multiply them by A, and I get W1, W2, WL, respectively. So now I have L vectors in my original space Rm, all Rn. So I have this first K and this remaining L vectors. They all live in the same space. Again, column space lives in Rm. kernel space lives in Rn. Now I have L vectors in Rn, V1, V2, up to Vk plus 7. If I prove that these vectors linearly independent and span Rn, that they form a basis in Rn. We know from the result of the previous week that every basis in Rn has the same number of elements, n. If this is true, then k plus l must be n, exactly what we claim. So basically, we have to prove two things, that my vectors v1, v2, vk, and then vk plus 1, vk plus 2, vk plus l span Rn and linearly independent. That's it. So if we prove that they span Rn, we prove that k plus l is bigger or equal than m. If we prove that they are linearly independent, we prove that they at most n. So you have k plus l bigger or equal than n and k plus l less than or equal than n. So it means k plus l is n. So let's do this separately. First, we prove that they span Rn. We have to show that every x in Rn is a linear combination of this guy. We do this slowly, very similar in some sense as a solution to the homework exercise 4 or 3, four, next one to the 2x2 matrices. You'll see this give you a hint how to solve this homework exercise. But anyway, let's do this. We do it slowly. We take X, we multiply it by A, and once we multiply it by A, using this remark, which I stressed several times, this guy lives in the column space. A times X is a linear combination of rows of columns of the matrix A taken with coefficients, which are coordinates of vector X. So we know that this guy lives in the column space. So it must be a linear combination of these vectors because they are basis of column space. So we get this. So if, yeah, but on the other hand, I also know by my choice that every vector W1, W2, WL is a vector, VK plus 1, VK plus 2, VK plus L multiplied by A. And then I put A outside. So I get this outside of the brackets, I factorize. So I have this by my construction. So you look, AX equal this guy for some number delta one delta. Now I take this vector here and I subtract it from vector X. And then I claim that X minus X hat is a kernel of A. Indeed, if I multiply this vector by A, I get AX minus AX hat, but AX equals AX hat. So it should be zero. So it's in the kernel of A. And now I say, oh, if this guy lives in the kernel of A, it must be a linear combination of these vectors because they form a basis of the kernel of A. So I get X minus X hat is lambda 1 V1 plus blah, 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 lambda K VK. So then it means that X is a linear combination of vectors V1 up to VK plus L. I just put X hat on the right hand side and use this equality. Okay, this proves that these vectors V1, V2 up to VK and then VK plus 1 up to VK plus L, all this bunch of vectors, they span Rn. In particular, we prove that K plus L is big at most N, so bigger or equal than N. Bigger or equal than N, okay. Okay, now we want to prove that they are linearly independent. Okay, good. And if we prove that they're linearly independent, it means they form, these vectors form a basis of Rn. Every basis of Rn has the same number of elements. So it means that K plus L equal to N because dimension of Rn is N. Okay, good. So how to prove that they're linearly independent? Yesterday during the tutorial, a lot of students asked me how to prove that some vectors linearly independent. By definition, you take the linear combinations with some coefficients lambda one up to lambda k plus l in this case, and you assume this linear combination is a zero vector. And then you have to prove that all numbers, all these coefficients, lambda one up to lambda k plus l, are zeros. This means linearly independent. So we suppose that exist some numbers, l, k plus l numbers. I split them, use different letters because these vectors has different natures. V1, vk were original vectors in the basis of kernel, and these ones we constructed. Yeah, I assume that I have this numbers such that the linear combination of my vectors with taken with coefficients, these numbers is zero. I have to prove that all these numbers is zero. If I prove that this equality implies that all the numbers here, lambda one, lambda k, delta one, delta l are zero, I'm done. And we proved the theorem. Okay, so you look at this. Okay, maybe let's do this to make lecture more entertaining. Let me ask you to type in the chat, what should I do now? I assume we have this equality, and maybe tell me what your subconscious wants to do now. Again, this vectors lives in Rn. Yeah. So any suggestion what we can, so for example, if I take this vector, yeah, and if I multiply it by A, I get WL. If I take this vector, if I multiply it by A, I got zero because it's in the kernel. So please type in the chat, what should I do now? What you think would be the nice move now? What should I do now to continue the proof? Basically, I have to click and then you will see what I'm gonna do now, but maybe you will give me some hint. Just to entertain you, yeah. Yeah, multiply the whole equation by A. Yeah, you multiply the whole equation by A. Then all of these guys disappear. They live in the kernel. If I multiply this by A, I get zero. Thank you. And all these vectors becomes W, because this is exactly how I found these vectors, VK plus one, VK plus L. So I have this, but my vectors W1, WL were linearly independent by assumption. They form a basis of the column space. So all these numbers has to be zero because these vectors are linearly independent. Now I take all of these zeros and substitute here. And I get this sum is zero. And then I use the fact that V1, VK are linearly independent because they form a basis of the kernel. And I get what I exactly want. Okay, so we prove that K plus L is N. We proved rank nullity theorem in full generality. I must admit, this proof has a weakness, one small weakness. Maybe to make this more interactive, can you type why you think this proof is not absolutely perfect? Okay, maybe maybe let me restate it. Let me restate my question. This proof is actually perfect. to be precise, okay, this is nice. What I just did, I think it was okay. I'm a little bit not satisfied with this. Okay, this and this together imply this, which is very nice. The dimension of the row space is the same as the dimension of the column space. But I really like my proof of this equality, but I'm a little bit unhappy with this. Can you type in the chat why you think I can be unhappy, or maybe why you are happy? If you're happy with this proof, just don't type anything. But if you feel a little bit uncomfortable with the proof of this corollary on this slide, please type why you think, why you're uncomfortable, why you don't like it. Okay. If you're all happy with this, then we proceed. Anyone who is unhappy with this corollary? It's a good corollary, it's true, but it could be better. Okay, my trick didn't work. So anyway, so I don't like the proof of this corollary because it really uses this lemma, which is based on the result we proved on Friday, which is based on dot products, which crucially uses the properties of real numbers. Somehow I would like my proof to be independent on real numbers. So for example, I want to repeat my proof for complex numbers, or I want to repeat my proof for any other numbers which I want to play with. I can literally repeat this proof of this theorem. I never use properties of real numbers in this proof. It works over any number. Unfortunately, this is not the case here. But there exists other proof of this corollary, which is independent on the properties of real numbers, which has, you can say, works for any field. You don't need to know it if you do not care about other numbers. But if you care about other numbers, then feel free to search for other proofs of this corollary. We cannot do this now because we don't have time. Okay, this proof, you see, I never use real numbers here. No? Okay, I use here Rn. I can put here Cn or Fn. So for any field. Okay, good. So this is a good proof. Okay, now using the corollary, which I presented three slides ago, we can define the rank of the matrix. This is probably the most important number you can relate to the matrix. And by definition, the rank of the matrix is a dimension of the column space, which is the same as dimension of the row space. Again, once you have a matrix, you cannot, for example, I cannot define the rank as a dimension of the column space alone. This would be not good towards rows. You cannot discriminate rows. Yeah. Also, I cannot define the rank as a dimension of the row space because this would be discrimination of columns. And we live in a democratic society, no one is discriminated. So I have to define the rank as both dimension of the column space, dimension of the row space. And thanks to the rank nullity theorem, this is the same number. So there's no problem here. Yeah. I must warn you that in many books, rank is defined in different way, in computational way. For example, in the pool book, rank is defined using a reduction to the row echelon form. So basically you give an algorithm how to compute this number, and then you define this number using this algorithm. I don't like this, but this is another way, more computational and less theoretical. I prefer this definition, and this is probably the most universal definition. Both are fine because one definition gives you the way how to find it. Yeah, alternatively, you can say using the properties of linearly independent vectors, you can say that the rank is the maximal number of linearly independent columns or the maximal number of linearly independent rows. Yeah, because you know that rows span the row space. So if you only keep the linearly independent one and take this maximal number of rows, this gives you the same span. They span the same set. Basically, if you take maximal number of linearly independent rows and you pick up these rows, which are linearly independent, they form a basis of the row space. All rows not necessary form a basis. They can be linearly dependent, but if you have some of them, you can find the basis. Yeah. So this is another way how you define the rank. It's also nice. And traditionally in many books, not in every book, but in many books, the dimension of the kernel also called the nullity. It just the name. I think maybe I'm wrong, but I think it's more American, but it's quite common and also it sounds good. So we have this rank nullity theorem. Rank of a matrix plus dimension of the kernel is n. It becomes the most symmetric statement of the rank nullity theorem, the most symmetric form of this theorem. Okay, let's consider in the remaining 10 minutes, let me slowly consider applications of this theorem, which I already discussed in the first lecture. But in the first lecture, we couldn't actually discuss it in detail because we didn't have tools from linear algebra. Now we have these tools. Now we know what's rank nullity theorem. And now we can actually discuss this application properly. Yeah. So let me remind you from the first lecture, if you've been on the first lecture, I presented the very nice theorem, special case of the very nice theorem called Schall theorem. Schall theorem basically tells you that if you take one cubic curve in the plane, curve given by polynomial equation of degree three, and you take another cubic curve in the plane given by some other polynomial equation of degree three, you assume that these curves intersect in 9 points. This is assumption. In this case, this is very explicit examples, which I cook up. This intersection can be computed. This intersection consists of exactly 9 points. 8 of them looks very nice. One is a bit uglier, but still okay. Yeah, and then Schall theorem says that every other cubic curve that contains the first 8 points must contain 9th point, this ugly looking point. So if you take any cubic polynomial which zero at these 8 points, it must be zero at this big point. Yeah, this theorem of course true in general, but this is just a special case. So yeah, this is a nice theorem from I guess maybe 18th century, 18 or 19. It is a generalization of the what is called the Pappus theorem or Pascal theorem about a hexagon inscribed in a conic. Yeah, so this is a generalization of some ancient theorem proved by in ancient Greece and in the ancient, okay, semi-ancient France by Pascal and Pappus. Pappus lived, oh, I think, 2000 years ago, and Pascal lived much earlier than Schall. Okay, but I don't want to explain why it's this theorem generalized the other two. Let me just show you that how to check this theorem in this particular case. And this gives you the idea how to prove this in general. Okay, how to prove the Schall theorem in this particular case? Okay, I take a cubic curve in R2. By definition, it's given by polynomial equation of degree three. I wrote here some polynomial equation and A1 up to A10 are some numbers. I don't know them, but I know that my, okay, I can assume that my curve C contains these 8 points. Yeah, this is my assumption of my theorem. What does it mean? It means that if you substitute coordinates of this point, of these 8 points into this equation, I get zero. So it means I substitute 2, 3 here, and I get some linear combination of A1, A2, and A10, and it's equal to zero. So I get these 8 equations. Now, if you look at these equations, you see that this is nothing but the kernel of some matrix. I just have to take this bunch of numbers, which is written here, all these numbers here, and I can put them into 8 by 10 matrix, and then multiply by A1, A2, up to A10. I just can rewrite this in the matrix form. Yeah, and then I can check the rank of the matrix. How to check the rank of this matrix? It's difficult, but computer can do this. Computer can check that this is 8. You can also do this, but it's gonna take some time. Basically, you need to compute either the rank of the kernel or you want to compute the rank of the column space, you need to prove that in this case, all rows of this matrix are linearly independent. By the book, you assume they're linearly dependent, and then you obtain a contradiction. It's actually time consuming, but any computer algebra system, the one available online for free, can do this in immediately, in less than 1/1000th of a second. You just click and you get number 8. So this is all algorithmic. Yeah, or if you have a Python, you can use a package in Python called Simpy, where you can compute it. I will present the code on the next slide. Yeah. And now you can use rank nullity theorem. You can say that solutions form two-dimensional vector space, because solutions are vectors in the kernel. Solutions of this linear system of linear equations defines you the kernel of this matrix. Rank is 8, so solution form a two-dimensional space. It means that any cubic, so if you have this, if you call this equation F and this equation, this polynomial, this is F1, this is F2, then what we proved that every cubic curve which contains 8 points are given by this equation, where F1 is an equation of C1 and F2 is equation of C2, the equation which I wrote already 3 slides ago. So this is equation of my C. But F1 is 0 in all these 8 points, also it's 0 at 9th point. And F2 is also 0 at 9th point. So if you take a 9th point, substitute it into this equation, you get lambda times 0 plus mu times 0. So which proves that C passes through the 9th point. So we proved Shai theorem in this particular case. Of course, in general, if you want to prove it in general, it's a bit more difficult, but the idea is roughly the same. You just need to put some more efforts to do this, but the idea is essentially the same. Okay, this show you that rank nullity theorem actually can be used to prove something. So this is not just abstract result, this is applicable result. Okay, this is a Python code. If you want to play with this, send me email. I can actually upload it to learn as well. So Python is free. This package Simpy is available. Yeah, so most of the lines of this code are self-explanatory. And basically you can actually see that this code mimic my proof. So I define the polynomial, I define the variables, I define the points. I define the points. I use rational to handle points as a rational numbers. I don't like decimals. Yeah. Yeah. And then you substitute coordinates of these points into my polynomials. You get 8 equations. By some reason, I call them L1 up to L8. Then you have this nice function which take system of equations and extract the matrix out of this. So this matrix which I created here, I didn't type, I extracted it from polynomial equations, basically using this Python package here. And then I just compute the rank and print. Okay, basically that's it. So this line gives you 8. And once you get 8, you finish the proof. But actually, I get a little bit more, if you may notice. So the remaining lines of this code is actually the way how I found equations of the curve C1 and C2. Of course, I didn't guess these equations. I found them using this Python package. Yeah, okay, there's a question in the chat, Verena. How did I get 2D space from this 8? Okay, look. If you look here in formula, Let me just translate this in the informal language. Okay, let's just do this. I'll answer the question after I finish the lecture. So basically, the remaining part of the code explains how I found these two curves. And also the very last line on the of the code tells me how I found intersection points. Actually, I didn't find them in some sense. I found these 8 points. I cooked up these 8 points. And then I found all curves which pass through them. I picked up 2, which gave me the basis, a base, some basis, yeah, in my kernel space. And then I solve 2 polynomial equations simultaneously, and I get 9th point. This is why 9th points is so ugly. First 8 points, I found them. I cooked them. I just picked up them to be relatively simple. And 9th point is found by computer. The sort of miracle, but it's not precisely a miracle, that this 9th point has also rational coordinates. It's a rational numbers, because these 8 points are rational numbers. This is not a coincidence. You can actually think how to prove this. This is not obvious, but this is true. Okay, so let me stop my lecture. So lecture is stopped. Let me stop the recording here.